want to ask a very specific, very almost instrumental kind of question. When kids come to me and ask me, and when an adolescent comes to me and asks me, I understand why we're different, but why we have to be this. We can even look at it in a very small kind of picture. Not even like why we have to be Jewish. Why we, not just we would like to be Christian and we stop being Jewish. Even like in a small, measurement. Like we are Ashkenazi and our way of halacha is Ashkenazi. But you know what? It's so much easier in many ways to be Sephardi because their halacha is so much more lenient. So why do we have to be what we are?
You know, I have tried to study for many years, but I have not remotely yet reached your madrega. Because, I can teach sort of postgraduates, but little children, it's completely above my level, I'm really bad at making things that simple. I really am. I just think very conceptually, and I wish I had a neat and beautiful answer to give you. And Edmund Burke used these words. I mean, they were not Jewish words. A Jew would have said them slightly differently. But as he said, society is a contract between the dead, the living, and those not yet born, which is the most Jewish idea you can get, except we would use the word brit, a covenant, rather than contract. That somehow or other, we are part of this chain. And we receive who we are from our parents. We hand it on to our children. And in the meantime, we improve, update, beautify, and what have you. I found myself, able to give a mashal for this because also in 2000, I became the first Jew ever to deliver a lecture in Windsor Castle, for Prince Philip. And I wanted to, Windsor Castle has been continuously inhabited by British kings and queens for 1,000 years. It's the oldest continually inhabited castle in history. And I was about to give this lecture, and I thought, the king, Edward II, who expelled the Jews in 1290, lived here. I want to stand up, mindful of all those exiled Jews looking down from heaven, and do something to be tover kvodam. So I began my speech, and I think I've written it in the beginning of my Haggadah, with these words. I said, Jews, this is a wonderful castle. Jews have never been allowed to stay long enough to build castles. We don't build castles. But we do have a building which we call home, which is every bit as beautiful as this castle. And it's made not out of bricks and stone, but out of words. And I said, I am trying to imagine what it is to inherit this castle. You suddenly realize that if you're Prince Philip or you're the Queen or King of England, you inherit this castle. What a privilege, you've inherited it. But you can't walk away from it. You can't knock it down and say, I'm going to build a bungalow instead, You inheriting that castle means you owe a duty to those who came before you. And you have to make sure it's intact and maybe improved for those who come after you. And that seems to me the mashal of what it is to be born a Jew. You have been given this royal castle built out of words. And it's been there for 4 times as long as Windsor Castle. And you inherited it. You can't knock it down and begin again. And you have to hand it on to generations afterward. Now, I wish I could give that in simple ABC so that a little kid could understand that, but that's how I understand it.
It seems to be especially appropriate, and you talk about being a minority, for the Jewish situation in Chutz Laretz. That the Jewish situation as a minority, it's easy to say that Judaism is a protest against the empire. It's easy to say that Judaism is a protest, I grew up that way, and Judaism is a protest against power. That Judaism is a protest against, the Nitziv, you mentioned the Nitziv, the totalitarian thrust of... Now the question would be, what happens and how to apply this idea in its less, in a less natural situation when Jews themselves have power.
It depends whether you take the maximalist, David HaMelech, Mashiachist view of Medinat Yisrael, or you take the minimalist view. I personally take the minimalist view, which is that yes, it would be wonderful, like the Abarbanel says, to have a utopian anarchy. You know, there shouldn't be Ein Lanu Melech Ela Ata. Aval, you know, Bayamim Haheim Ein Melech BiYisrael Ish Hayesha Beinav Yaseh. That's the closing line of Sefer Shoftim. So that is Judaism, this conflict between freedom and order. How do you resolve it? The ideal realization of that, according to Abarbanel, according to the way I see things, is we shouldn't need a king because we are the only people commanded not just to keep the law, but to be a nation of constitutional lawyers. The minimalist theory says you have only as much government as you need to secure rule of law within and defense of the realm from enemies without. Yeah, that is what in America they call the night watchman state, minimalist governance. And the whole burden of what it is to be Jewish lies not with Medina, but with Chevra, what in English they call civil society, family, community, charity, all the rest of it. In other words, you try and power is a necessity, but there should be as little of it as possible. And what should be maximized is Kol Yisrael Arevin Ze B'Zeh, the covenantal principle that at local neighborhood, family, neighborhood, locality level, people help each other out. That's what Torah is all about. Sof Kol Sof, you apply that to Israel by saying, we now need to build a strong civil society. And the task of a state in liberal democracy is not to make people good, it is to make people live in peace with one another. That is what makes liberal democracy compatible with Judaism in a way that Athenian democracy is not compatible with Judaism.
Following on from your point about the job of government here to be to have people live in peace together, but not to make them good. That may be true of government, but when it comes to education, we perhaps have a different challenge on our hands. That public education in Israel has the challenge of indeed trying to make people good. What is possible under this rubric of, or this this blueprint you have for particularism and universalism living together? How might that work in a society like Israel's, where we do want to educate people to the good, and yet we have these people who speak this variety of cultural languages, have these variety of different commitments?
You know, there was a big row on traffic on Shabbos in, when was it, 10 years ago? Which Rehov was it? What? Rehov Bar Ilan. And I'm thinking here they're fighting a war over cars on Shabbos in Rehov Bar Ilan. In London, to this day, on Sunday, you can't drive in any of the roads near Buckingham Palace. And nobody fights a war over this, and nobody says Britain is a theocratic state or a medieval monarchy. Are you with me? There's a certain derech eretz for the fact that it's Sunday and the Queen is the head of the Church of England, and, you know, on Sunday you don't drive a car past the Queen's house, you know. There is such a thing as preserving in the Rishut HaRabim that religious cultural imperative that makes the nation what it is and that still allows Britain, which has an established church for Pete's sake. Every day Parliament begins with Christian prayers. So I, as a Rav, cannot go into the House of Lords for the first 5 minutes, but Baruch Hashem, in the House of Lords, they daven a very quick mincha with no chazar hashatz, and you know, it's only 5 minutes, so it's beseder. But I don't feel excluded, not least because, you know, I know that we invite the Queen or Prince Philip or Prince Charles to open a Jewish school, they come. They make us feel important, and they do the same for the Sikhs and the Hindus and the Muslims, even though they are the heads of the Church of England. To have an established religion in a country does not mean that country has to be intolerant. It can be ultra-tolerant, because it recognizes that other people have other religions, and they're also citizens of the state, and therefore the head of state must respect them. So you see what a price we pay in Israel, whether we look at it from, you know, the Chol side of things or the Kodesh side of things. I say, are you with me? So I am expected, and every English child is expected, to know Shakespeare. I mean, you can't be English without knowing Shakespeare, without a little bit of Milton, a little bit of whatever. Without a bit of English music, you know. I mean, how could you imagine an educational system without teaching you Shakespeare? So this is a matter of basic cultural literacy. Then in Israel, everyone should be educated to have a knowledge of Tanakh, a knowledge of the Chagim, a knowledge of the structure of Tefillah. That is basically what it is to live in an Israeli culture. Tarbut, forget the word dat. Tarbut does not command, but it is essential to identity. So how this ever got so politicized that even highly literate people in America, in Israel, didn't know the basics, I still to this day cannot understand.